Welcome back. You're watching To The Point. There's no doubt there's enormous excitement about President Obama's arrival in just over 2 days' time. But what major outcomes can his visit deliver? A whole range of items is being speculated about, but is that list realistic or just hype and excitement? My guests are India's former ambassador to America, Meera Shankar, former secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs, KC Singh, the strategic affairs editor of the Business Standard, Ajay Shukla, and joining us from London, the South Asia Bureau Chief of Reuters, John Chalmers. Meera Shankar, there have been reports in papers like The Hindu and The Indian Express that the United States and India are about to resolve their differences over India's nuclear liability law. And then today the news that the contact group has extended its talks in London by another day have bolstered those hopes considerably. Yes. But do you believe these reports are credible, or do you think there's a huge element of wishful thinking here?
Well, there is a possibility that, we could find practical ways to move forward. I think the Indian government has made a proposal for an insurance pool, in a sense, to address the concerns on nuclear liability. And they are having talks in the contact group.
But in
so
just
let's see.
The 3 days left, do you think they can actually come to a resolution?
Well, let's see if they are able to. It will be a hat trick if they can.
There and hat tricks, as you know, are things that don't get pulled off every day. Now, KC Singh, it all hinges on, first of all, whether the idea of an insurance pool set up by the GIC can actually take care of the right to recourse under Section 17B. And then secondly, whether the two countries, and this may be more difficult, can devise a legally binding assurance that compensation claims won't be sought under the tort law. Do you really believe that those two difficult steps can be taken in just the 3 days left? After all, it's something we've been struggling over between the two countries for 6 years.
Yes, you're right. They've been at it for ever since the bill was passed. So there's a lot of groundwork which has been done. It's not something which is starting yesterday. They're trying to work with the language of the act here, with the concerns, and to find a practical solution, whether via way of insurance or some other means. First, they tried via the international route, taking the IAEA and the commitments there. That didn't seem to work. But overall, it'll have to remain in line with the spirit of the law passed, because that can't be amended.
Now, Meera Shankar, there is a third issue which has got very little attention in India, but it has got a lot of prominence in America, and that's the question of tracking and accounting for nuclear material supplied by the US. The Americans, to put it briefly, want that tracking of their equipment done by a system that's under their control. India, on the other hand, believes it should be done through the IAEA, with whom we've already been negotiating. Can this problem, which some say is a bigger problem, be sorted out as well?
Well, it is a big problem, because India's view is that we have safeguards from the International Atomic Energy Agency, and those are the safeguards that we have accepted under the India-US nuclear deal.
The Americans, however, want the thing to be controlled by them.
Let's see how it moves forward.
Are you more skeptical here than you were on the insurance front?
I think both are issues. I think the clause 17 is not so much an issue, because
but the tort 146.
The tort one is, because it's not as though supplier liability is not included in Indian saying that it would be contingent on the contract. I mean, so
Ajay Shukla, let's come to an area where, in fact, there are equally great expectations of an outcome, and that is to do with the fact that everyone believes that the two countries, when President Obama comes, will sign a new 10-year defense framework agreement, as well as step up production of defense equipment under the Defense Technology and Trade Initiative. Now, in an article that you wrote for your paper, The Business Standard, on the 21st, you seem to clearly suggest that both of these were outcomes that would happen. Have I understood you correctly?
Well, the signing of the defense framework agreement is a high likelihood. I think that I've not perhaps managed to explain the DTTI part of it, the Defense Technology and Trade Agreement part. This is not a specific sort of, shall I call it, an outcome, a deliverable. The DTTI is basically a structure that allows both the bureaucracies, the US bureaucracy and the Indian bureaucracy, both of which are extremely hidebound bureaucracies, rule-driven, procedure-oriented, this allows them to work through their various systems and reach agreement, find ways to bypass rules and regulations and so on, or well, maybe not bypass them, but to not allow them to scuttle frameworks. So I don't think that the DTTI should be seen as something that will make things happen in terms of agreements, but it's a mechanism for resolving disputes.
John Chalmers, there are two things that the Americans are very keen on, which increasingly it seems are unlikely to fructify. The first is a bilateral investment treaty, because here the problem seems to be that India is in a process of reviewing its existing treaties with other countries, and Delhi feels that until that review is finished, they ought not to sign a new treaty with Washington. And then the second problem is the differences between the two countries over intellectual property rights. Although they've narrowed fairly considerably, there are still, I'm told, significant differences that remain. Will this be a disappointing outcome from the American point of view?
You've made the point that on both issues, the investment and the intellectual property rights, there are still major hurdles to be cleared. And although, as we've already discussed, on issues like nuclear liability, both sides have been pulling all the stops out to get that across the line for this meeting. I think on these other ones, like investment, intellectual property, climate, in general, kind of a tax deal, so on, free trade agreement, these are all things which I think are going to take much more time to come. And this is really, this meeting is more about establishing a better relationship. Let's face it, that a year ago, where were we in relations between the world's two largest democracies, particularly with the Kopragade affair? We've come a very long way since then, and I think it would be, certainly the signals we're getting from diplomats that we're speaking to is that the expectations should be quite low in terms of things that you can sign. But in terms of what you can get out of it from a geostrategic and relationship point of view are enormous.
So in other words, in fact, the mere fact they're meeting, and it's such a high-profile meeting, that symbolism is the real message. Don't worry about deliverables per se. Am I right?
That's correct. I mean, remember that, until last year, Narendra Modi was denied a visa to visit the United States. Barack Obama will be the first sitting U.S. president to visit India twice, and he will be the first U.S. president to be chief guest at a Republic Day parade. That's not insignificant.
Now, Meera Shankar, from the Indian point of view, there are also a couple of areas where perhaps the Americans are not going to concede Indian requests. One, I'm told, is the totalization agreement. Yeah. And another, I'm told, is the visa liberalization we're looking for, particularly with regard to H-1B and perhaps even L-1 visas, mm-hmm. both of which, fairly soon, are going to cost considerably more. Will New Delhi be disappointed, or will New Delhi take that in its stride?
Well, I think the two countries will continue to engage on these issues. I think you can't expect solutions, but what you will probably get is a commitment to continue engagement on these issues.
But that they've already
and,
got.
And, well,
they got that in September.
Yes, but it'll be an ongoing thing. And then on areas like IPR, I would say there are practical ways to move ahead. Look at the recent agreement that Gilead has signed. They have licensed their HIV drug to an Indian producer to produce and sell in India and in certain developing countries. Obviously, this is at lower price points. So I think we have to find practical ways rather than saying, this is my perspective or this is, your perspective, and either you embrace mine or I embrace yours. I think it will not be like that.
But can I put that at you? Summits are usually occasions for that compromise to be reached. Now, if this summit isn't an occasion for that compromise to be reached, doesn't it actually suggest that the push that's necessary for compromise is missing?
I think that these are compromises which are at the business level. They're not at the level of the law. Like, take copyright, for instance. I'll give you an example.
Quickly.
The book publishing industry used to find, you know, many fake rip-offs in India. Then they started, they found that they couldn't beat them. So they decided to bring out Indian, special Indian editions of their books, which hit the market almost the same time as their books in Europe, sometimes
All
before,
right. In other
and
words,
very cheap. So you look for business solutions.
All right, it's a bit like McDonald's. If you can't sell a beef burger in India, make it a chicken burger
chicken
and still call it a hamburger. Casey saying, what about trade? India-US trade in December 2013, or rather for the year ending December 2013, was $90 billion. And the two countries want to push it up to $500 billion, but they don't have a trade agreement. Is that a problem? And will achieving a trade agreement be difficult, as some business papers suggest?
I think more than a specific trade agreement, we have to be careful that US is negotiating two different trade agreements, one with Europe and one with the Trans-Pacific Partnership, what is called TPP. Now, you don't want to get locked out of them. I think instead of individual issues, what this visit and the engagement is about is to do the strategic engagement at the highest level and then push the things down, and which is what Bush did. Because what has happened over the last couple of years is that individual stakeholders on both sides have taken over their own issues and become very evangelical about them. Now, the only way if you have a strategic engagement is for the people at the top to say, we have to find solutions. Some will be found now, some later. But I think more than a specific agreement with US, we need to understand how the deal, for instance, the US agreement with the transatlantic agreement with Europe, they said may affect the Brazilian trade by 15%, may affect even the Chinese trade. So where do we lie in this? We don't want to get locked out of it. Those are the kind of issues that I think Prime Minister needs to discuss with the President. And don't forget, accompanying the President is both the Commerce Secretary as well as a US trade representative.
So there's a good chance there that they can, if they put their heads together, come up with sensible solutions. Now, Ajay Shukla, something that is happening, although it's not talked about so much, is a huge expansion in the military exercises the two countries carry out together. I'm told that, in fact, India carries out more exercises with America at this point of time than it does with any other country. There's also a huge stepping up of intelligence sharing, and now there's talk also of working together on cyber security. Is that whole area of military exercises, intelligence and cyber security a blossoming area in the relationship between the two?
The sharing of intelligence is a real plus point. The United States is now providing India intelligence on areas that it was very reluctant to provide intelligence on earlier. Specifically, the Lashkar-e-Taiba, Pakistani army activities and interfaces with these militant groups. This is all on the table and a part of the ongoing exchanges, and it really equips India very well to deal with them. Naturally, India is providing equipment, information in return as well, and information that is very useful to the United States. So that's definitely a plus point. However, on the exercises, this is it's really a plus and a minus story. While the United States does do more exercises with India than it does with other countries, the level of sophistication of the exercises and the usefulness of the exercises has actually gone down over the last 3 years. And that was largely due to the reluctance of the Mr. Antony ministry under the United Progressive Alliance to engage with the United States. So, in the last 2 or 3 years, you've seen a downtrend in the exercises,
okay.
But everybody's optimistic now that they'll pick up and they'll start moving forward again.
John Chalmers, let's come to the political dimension of this relationship. For India and America, often the elephant in the room is actually Pakistan. But at the moment, there are reports that there are reports in India that the Americans have cautioned Islamabad against any incident while Obama is in India. Earlier, Secretary of State Kerry had in fact told Pakistan to take tougher action against the LET. Today, PTI is reporting that Pakistan has in fact banned both the JUD and the Fala in Insaniyat. And earlier PTI was reporting that London and Washington have put pressure on Islamabad either to hand over Zaki ur Rahman Lakhvi to India or to hand him over to one of them to face trial. Now, if that entire concatenation of reports is correct and believable, does it suggest that America is exercising pressure on Pakistan, perhaps somewhat at least at the behest of India?
I think there's no question from what everything that you've just said that America is exercising pressure on Pakistan. That's for sure. How far that's at the behest of, or as you know, as part of some kind of alliance with New Delhi, that's not so clear. I think it is very clear that the United States and India now see eye to eye on kind of many geostrategic issues, and perhaps, if you like, the elephant in the room is more China than it is Pakistan. And I think the big takeaway, in a way, from this event, even before this visit of Obama, is that Narendra Modi is moving India out of its traditional, if you like, non-alignment comfort zone. And to some extent, that's sort of what the United States wants to see. And taking it out of that non-alignment zone really means that he wants to reclaim, in particularly, the South Asian periphery from China. And so I think there's much more of a China thing going on here than there is Pakistan.
Let me put that China question to you, Mr. Shankar. What do you think Obama will say to Modi, and what will Modi say to Obama about their mutual respective relationship with China? Because for both of them, China is increasingly a country of concern.
Well, it is a country of concern, and I think both really look to see how they can shape an Asian balance which would not really be under the dominance of any one country, I mean particularly China. At the same time, it's more complex because it's not a strategy of containment, because both countries have very vibrant economic relations. For instance, the US economic relationship with China is huge, and
as is ours.
And politically they see China as their most important interlocutor.
So it's a tricky one for both countries.
So it's a balance between engagement and at the same time putting in place relationships,
okay,
which could help to shape this balance.
KC Singh, what about Afghanistan? With American troop levels now down to just about 10,000, what sort of questions do you think Mr. Modi will ask Mr. Obama about the future of Afghanistan, and what sort of assurance can President Obama give Mr. Modi that Kabul's not going to fall into the hands of the Taliban?
I think it'll be an interesting question which will be discussed, and also in combination with Pakistan. Because there are any number of alternative futures possible for Afghanistan, ranging from a slow settling down Pakistan is capable of. But therefore, US remains a very important factor, both in terms of their relationship with Saudis, UAE, Gulf countries, which can put pressure. And we cannot go back to the 1990s or early 2000s, because it's not the same Iran, it's not the same Russia, it's not the same Northern Alliance. So I think the strategic reality of Afghanistan has changed. And Indian and US interests converge that we want a stable Afghanistan in which no neighbor tries playing an extraordinary or interfering role. Now, how you do that, I think US can become a very important partner, and Pakistan can be a third interlocutor, because India-Pakistan relations will get impacted if Pakistan-Indian rivalry spills over into Afghanistan.
Finally, Ajay Shukla, let's come to the personal relationship between the two men. Many people believe that Mr. Modi will want to return the Martin Luther King favor shown to him in Washington. And there's speculation that he might accompany the president to Rajghat. There's also some speculation that he might even accompany the president to the Taj Mahal. Do you have any inkling of what Mr. Modi will want to do to make a special gesture?
Well, one thing does appear. It's an interesting question you pose. Look at the way that he treated Xi Jinping in Ahmedabad where they were on in a very casual setting, they were swinging together and so on a Gujarati style jhula. So it's pretty certain that Mr. Modi will have a couple of gestures and surprises up his sleeve. Now, what it's going to be, I wouldn't hazard a guess. He has the capacity to surprise and he has the capacity to play the big symbolic gestures. And that's one of the reasons why he does so well at building up relations with foreign leaders. So I guess we'll just have to wait and see what he does.
John Chalmers, one last question about President Obama himself. There are some unkind comments in America that Obama is only coming to India for a parade and to visit the Taj. In fact, his critics say he's ignoring his domestic agenda and thus making himself a lame duck very early on by coming to India. Is there any truth in that criticism, or is it just unfair and prejudiced?
Well, he's a politician, and we're heading into elections not far off in Washington. These are the kind of things that people will say. This is the second time that he's been to India, and I think he's seizing the opportunity of a new prime minister here to take relations to a different level, and they've really struggled for so very long. I think it does take two hands to clap. It's not just a question of Narendra Modi inviting Obama. He rolled out the red carpet for Modi just a few months after he'd become prime minister. I think he's very serious about the need for a better relationship between Washington and New Delhi, and I think that's why he's doing it. So obviously there will be those kinds of criticisms, but I think he genuinely actually sees the benefit for both sides in this.
One quick question, and I'd be grateful, John Chalmers, for a quick answer. Is this visit attracting much attention in the West, particularly in America and particularly in London where you are? It's an enormous story in India, but is it attracting much attention in the West?
No, I'm afraid it's not. Maybe once he gets there it will, but there's obviously the build-up is going to be of much more interest to people in India. Once he's there and people start seeing the images on the TV, then people will start talking about it.
All right, there we end this particular episode. My thanks to all four of my guests for joining me, who have been. Thanks for watching. But before I wrap up, I just need to inform my viewers that tomorrow's show is a special one, and it's part of the India Today Global Roundtable, where I will be moderating a special session with Seshadri Chari, editor of Agni, and a former editor of Organizer, Manish Tiwari, former Union Minister for Information and Broadcasting, and Abdul Basit, the present Pakistani High Commissioner to India. And the topic for discussion will be India, Pakistan, and America, a question of trust. That's tomorrow at 8 p.m. on my show.